and welcome everyone. If it's your first time here, I hope you enjoy whatever you may find in the center. And for those who are here last year and back here again, welcome back. Now, before I move on, and don't be misled by what Justin said, I'm not going to give you big picture about what science and artificial intelligence. I am actually neither artificial nor intelligent. Okay, I'm a scientist, I'm a biologist by training. So what I'm going to say is from the biologist's point of view. And I also like to confess that because you are all experts, I feel I shouldn't be what the Chinese always taught us. If you're not an expert, don't try to show off. There's this phrase called pan men nong fu. Okay, for those who may not know, there's this very famous family, they're called Lu Pan, and they are very good carpenters. They make very good wood carving and all kinds of things. So the phrase used since I was young is, don't ever wave an axe in front of the Pan family. So I shall not go into too much about technical thing, but just more of how I see this topic of artificial intelligence and science. And first, I think all of you agreed earlier on, Harish talked about not man-made, okay? To me, it's inspired by nature. And it is enabled through the very hot word now called STEM, Science, Technology, Engineering, and Maths. And in Science Center, we shout the slogan of STEM equals the power to create, to create solutions, to create possibilities. And artificial intelligence, to me, is the product of STEM, the power to create artificial intelligence. And towards the end, I'd like to bring up this thing about, is artificial intelligence a double-edged sword? Just like when, at the turn of the millennium, when everybody talk about molecular biology, life sciences, the Human Genome Project is going to transform the way we live, and suddenly everybody jump into that big bandwagon, and we soon realize that the power to play with life through the power of life sciences make us wonder how to balance the good and the evil. When you are able to play God, so-called, what is the ethical consideration? So with that, we came up with bioethics. And incidentally, I sit in the Singapore Biotic Advisory Committee. And shown here is a very old comic. I grew up reading that comic. It's called Ti Qiu Xian Feng Hao. I cannot translate that into English. You know, it's a robot, and it's, this robot, his mission is to protect Earth. And when I was very young, this robot is a character that I could draw perfectly without referring to it. I don't know whether I can recall how to draw it, but it is very inspiring when I was young looking at this robot called Ti Qiu Xian Feng Hao. I think if I had to translate it, it's like the pioneer, the first one to go out to protect Earth. And of course, through times, things have moved in great ways. And as a biologist, I like to draw to how now artificial intelligence is even down to the molecular level. Now, all cells have got cytoskeletal structure, and with signals coming in, they can change shape. Like our immune cells can come and engulf foreign bodies, things like this. And there are already work done to show that you can create very, very small micro, nano-sized kind of actuator. And through cell signaling kind of mechanism, you can make the cell shape change and therefore direct the cells to move to somewhere else. So this is, well, you can refer to the website that I put up there. So this is artificial intelligence all the way to the cellular level. Of course, you may wonder, is a cell intelligent cell? All of us know about DNA programming our cells, and all of us sometimes blame that it's all our genes making us behave the way we behave. So the programmable part of our DNA to express our genotype, phenotype, is something that has got influence to the way we look at artificial intelligence. And from cells to synapse, synapses are cell-cell communication, and all of us without synapses, you and I don't have to talk about intelligence at all, because it is through synapses that we transmit signals from our periphery to our brain and our brain to the periphery. And in the neural network setting, since I'm not in the PAN family like you, I shall not go into that. And all of us know about how robots are going to be living with us. Again, these are some work shown lately. You can see how robots are learning to be intelligent. They can learn how to fetch objects by learning, by trying. Robots, social robots, robotic arms are now part and parcel of life. Incidentally, we are also bringing the robotic arm competition to Singapore. So some of you who are in the robotic domain, we'll be very happy to talk with you about how we could work with you in terms of promoting artificial intelligence with robots. And I was very inspired by this when I saw it in YouTube newspaper. It's a bio-inspired flying robot pollinator. So now it's possible to drive a small drone, almost like a honeybee, going around to pollinate flowers. I mean, you wonder why this machine is being created. I think, first of all, it's a demonstration of possibilities. Like I said, STEM, the power to create possibility. So this may one day be a very interesting solution for many things. Some of you may be aware that certain bees are already so-called endangered. Some are already going to the extinct link list. And of course, drones can be used for many, many other tasks and other so-called services for mankind. And again, I want to advertise a little bit about Science Center. We are putting up an initiative called the Game of Drones. It's a challenge of drones. We are going to open up the competition, and it's a collaboration with the Singapore Computer Society. They are celebrating 50th anniversary. We are celebrating 40th anniversary. 50 years and 40 years of experience coming together. We're going to bring this Game of Drones. Again, among you, if any of you are interested to come onto this with us, we are at the very beginning stage. Next week, Monday, I'm supposed to go to our Ministry of Education to present our proposal. And it is something that we are very excited about. Again, I welcome you to talk to us about your interest in being part of this drones challenge. We intend to grow it into an international platform in 3 years' time. And this year, we are targeting 100 teams to take part. Okay. And of course, among you, you're also looking to sensor, foldable touch screens, and all these are material science combining with the computer science. And wearable is something that is already in place. Wearable AI system can even detect what you talk, what you say. 3 weeks ago, we have MTech Asia in Singapore, and one of the speakers, Adrian Chok, came and talked about Internet of Things. And he was demonstrating a lot of interesting things about how wearable things can sense one another, including how you can even kiss somebody through a gadget, and your girlfriend, your wife, your mistresses far, far away can sense the way you kiss. So these are very interesting things about wearable, about machine and connecting humans, either conversation, emotion, across via machines, via computers, via Internet of Things. So I'll just very quickly run through some examples of how nature inspired artificial intelligence. And indeed, nature is the perfect showcase of designs and intelligence. You look around, many, many things around us. We are just simply amazed by the beauty and by the intelligence that is within. Some may be very insignificant looking, but as we all know, even the squid may be smarter than us. Biology-inspired technology brings us closer to understanding life in general and also us as a human being. Early on, Harish talked about consciousness. All these are part and parcel of being a human. And we all know that robots, robotics and AI is moving very fast and really mimicking us. And sometimes they even perform better than us. But I think we need to really be mindful of the fundamental differences between machines and humans. I wouldn't have time to go into the story of Golan and Frankenstein. Those are, in a way, man-made, but ended up needing us to make very hard decisions whether to destroy them or not. I will quickly close off. All of you must be aware of Google's new AI, having machine learning, and then learn how to collect as many apples as possible. And at the end, they learn to be very aggressive. The smart ones started to sabotage to make sure that it's a sure win case. On the other hand, they also learn how to be cooperative. Another game make them train to learn to cooperate with one another. And this is my final slide. That machine learning and trying to sabotage one another, try to outperform and become very aggressive, give us a glimpse of how we really need to pay attention to the ethics of AI. I don't have to read this to you. My question as a biologist who loves science and like the word love very much, I just wonder if among the audience, anybody can answer that question. So there's no Q&A, but I give you this question for you to answer. So with that, I thank you very much for your attention.